Then you put in a whole clove of garlic. The processor will take care of the garlic, that'll mash it up. And then here I've got the contents of a tin of anchovies. And what I'm going to do is, this is a 2-ounce tin, the oil has been drained off, I'm just going to put 2 anchovies into the rest, that gets whizzed up into the dressing, and the rest of the anchovies go into the salad later. And then the next ingredient is the juice of a lime. Now you can use a lemon, but a lime has a really lovely sort of sharp, fragrant, summery flavour. Now just switch the motor on and blend those ingredients thoroughly. The anchovy and the garlic are getting all mashed up into a pulp with the egg and the lime juice. And then when they're thoroughly blended, we're going to add some oil. And what I've got here is 1/4 pint of, again, nice extra virgin fruity olive oil. You can see by the colour there. And we're going to slightly emulsify this sauce, which means put the motor on and let the oil just go in a steady stream. Now there is something else in with this oil, and that's the oil, do you remember, from the tin of anchovies. I told you I drained it off. Well, I put it in there because that oil has some good flavour for this. Just pour it in a steady stream. Now sometimes people have problems with emulsified sauces because they curdle. And the classic mayonnaise, of course, is adding oil slowly to egg yolks. But if you use a whole egg, as I have done here, there's no danger of that at all. You won't have any problems. As long as you just pour it in a thin, steady stream. You can speed up the speed a bit if you want to. Now as it begins to mix, you can get a little bit more bold with the oil at the end. What you should end up with is a sauce that's the consistency of pouring cream. So we'll just take this over now and finish making the salad by dressing it. We'll just get rid of the blade here. And over here I've got a bowl of mixed leaves. Now I call this one mixed leaf Caesar salad. Traditionally it's always made with this one, cos lettuce. But I like a mixture, so I've got cos lettuce, Webb's lettuce, and the lovely rocket as well. And it's going to have one more ingredient before I just put the dressing on, and that is those anchovies I showed you earlier. And what we're going to do with those is just snip them with the scissors over the leaves. It's quite a lot of anchovy flavour in this, and I think that's what gives it such a lovely, sort of really gutsy, outdoor summery flavour. Also, this adds a bit of contrast to the leaves, nice sort of pinky brown colour. There we are. Now we will pour in the dressing. I just want to show you a little bit of kitchen equipment before I do that, because I think this is something rather special, very simple. It's a spatula, but it's a very, very good spatula. It's made sort of like a little shovel shape, spoon shape. And it really does clean dishes and bowls better than anything I've ever used before. So that's something to recommend. Now, just take the dressing out. You can see the consistency as it's going in there. I wanted to show you my spatula, and in fact it's not really sticking much, so I can't. I'll show it to you again on something else that we make later on. Now, that's fairly clean, isn't it? Now, there's the dressing. What we're going to do now is go in there with a spoon and a fork and give it a nice bit of tossing. And the idea here is to get all the leaves beautifully glistening and coated with that gorgeous dressing. You might want to taste a leaf here and add a little bit of pepper and salt. I didn't put any in the beginning because, of course, there is salt in the anchovies, but before you serve it, it's a good idea to just have a little taste there and see. One more ingredient, sorry, two more. But the first one is Parmesan cheese, and this is Reggio Parmesan cheese, which is the strong one. And I've got 1.5 ounces here. And that's just going to be sprinkled over the leaves. And then we're going to give it one more little toss. And then the last ingredient is the one we started out with, and that's the crisp, crunchy croutons that are waiting there in the side wings. And when you make croutons, whatever you do, hide them, because people start to eat them, and you find when you go to make the salad, you haven't got any left. They're very, very Moorish croutons, especially with the cheese. So that's the last ingredient now. Now this will make a very aristocratic first course at a summer dinner party or a lovely lunch outside in the garden for four people. Either way, I hope when you make this, you will agree with me that it really is the best salad in the world. I always remember Margaret Costa, one of our greatest cookery writers, writing in her Four Seasons cookbook about the sound of tart green gooseberries raining down into the pan like hailstones. And to me, that heralds the sound of summer and the sound of some lovely gooseberry recipes. And I'm going to show you a really splendid gooseberry recipe today. This is something that tastes good and, if you're in a hurry, is very, very easy to make. You start off in a nice, wide, shallow baking dish. This one's 9 inches. With 2 pounds of gooseberries. And traditionally in England, gooseberries have always had a wonderful affinity with the flavour of elderflower heads. And we used to go out and collect elderflower heads, wrap them in muslin and cook them with the gooseberries to impart their flavour. But now, some clever person has invented this lovely stuff, which is elderflower cordial. And this is much more easy. And so for this recipe, I'm going to use 2 tablespoons of this elderflower cordial and just sprinkle it over the gooseberries. And because when they're first in season, they're quite sharp, you need quite a bit of sugar in them. So I've got 4 ounces here of caster sugar, so we'll sprinkle that in. And if you're wondering what this recipe is called, I'm about to tell you that it's called English gooseberry cobbler. And now we're going to make the cobbler topping. And if you've got a food processor, it really is actually made in moments. And you start off with 8 ounces of sifted flour. And this has had added to it 3 teaspoons of baking powder and 1/2 teaspoon of salt. So that goes into the goblet of the processor first. And then another easy thing about this recipe is that you can use butter straight from the refrigerator. It's supposed to be quite hard from the refrigerator, and that's good for people like me who always forget to take it out in time for pastry. Slice it up a little bit into chunks before it goes in. And if you want to use margarine, you can use margarine, that's okay. Lid goes on. And then you just switch on for about 30 seconds. What you want is the butter and the flour to resemble fine breadcrumbs. So we'll switch on. Shaking about a bit because the butter is hard. When you have the early summer fruits like rhubarb and gooseberries, you need to have cooked recipes for these because obviously you can't eat them raw like you can the raspberries and strawberries later on. And this is a real winner, this one. Now, when the mixture resembles fine breadcrumbs, the next thing you do is you add this, which is buttermilk. Now, I've got 6 fluid ounces of buttermilk. If you look in the supermarket round the dairy counter, you'll probably find buttermilk. It's quite widely distributed now, but don't worry if you can't find it. You can actually use ordinary milk and you'll still have a lovely cobbler. Now we're just going to give that another little mix. And what happens now is once the buttermilk gets blended into the rest of the ingredients, you end up with a really sort of funny, sludgy mixture. And you think, what on earth am I going to do with that? It looks awful. But don't worry, you're not going to have to roll it out or anything nasty like that. All that happens is take it over to the gooseberries, just take away the blade and clean some of the gunge off. It really is a very, very funny, sticky mixture, this. And then all you do is you just take spoonfuls of the mixture and just pop them on top of the gooseberries. It's as simple as this. just like that, haphazardly. What happens is when it goes in the oven, you'll find the scone mixture begins to rise up and spread out, but it doesn't quite join up. And so you get sort of lovely little pools of gooseberries in between, which looks really, really pretty. Now the difference between an English and an American cobbler is the American one has a kind of scone pastry which goes underneath and on top. But this one is so easy to do, you just put the blobs on top. And then it has one more ingredient, and this is actually crushed sugar cubes. I've got 6 Demerara sugar cubes here, and they've been crushed quite coarsely. If you don't have sugar cubes, you can just put Demerara sugar on top. But if you crush them like this, coarsely, then you get a lovely sort of crusty, crunchy topping, which I think just finishes this off beautifully. Now this goes into a hot oven, gas mark 7 or the equivalent, and you leave it there on a reasonably high shelf for about 25 to 30 minutes until the scone topping has become lovely and crusty and golden.
Here are some of the other gooseberry recipes that appear in the book. First, a gooseberry fool. This one's made with a puree of gooseberries and some lovely thick Greek yogurt. These are gooseberry jellies. They're made with sparkling wine and flavoured with elderflower cordial. This is something called rice cream, made with an Italian arborio rice and served with a gooseberry puree. And finally, some sunny gooseberry preserve to brighten up your breakfast in the winter.
So here we are. This is our gooseberry cobbler. And of course, you don't have to be tied down to making this just with gooseberries. You can make it with any kind of fruit. As the season goes on, it's nice with all different kinds of fruits. Well, I think the nicest thing to serve with a gooseberry cobbler is actually gooseberry and elderflower ice cream. But if you want to know how to make that, you'll have to come back and join me next time when our programme is going to be all about ice cream. So I'll see you then. Welcome to a programme in which the title says it all, because all the world really does love an ice cream. Doesn't matter where you go, whatever country you visit, everybody always now and then loves to have an ice cream. In fact, I would say it's the world's universal food.
Ice cream, you scream, we all scream for ice cream, baby. That's what we want. Monday, Tuesday, every day is ice day, baby. That's what we like. You can have your chocolate or vanilla, but still it's ice cream we like best. Ice cream, you scream, we all scream for ice cream, baby. That's what we want, yeah.
But the trouble is, it's not always that easy to find really good ice cream. There's a lot of rubbish sold up and down the country in the name of ice cream. However, Caroline Liddell and Robin Weir have been studying the subject of making ice cream over the past few years, and they've come up with what I think is the really definitive book on the subject.
I think nowadays most people would define us as fanatics, ice cream fanatics. And it all started in a thoroughly innocuous way, walking into a supermarket some 5 years ago now, and putting a carton of ice cream into the supermarket trolley, but on getting it home, reading the list of ingredients and discovering to our horror that there were barely a recognisable ingredient in the whole list, most of them chemical in fact.
And the amazing thing was that of the 13 ingredients, nowhere on the package did cream appear. So we then started digging to find out about this and discovered that probably 80% of the ice cream that's sold in England would not be allowed to be sold in either the common market or in the United States as ice cream. So we then started looking further into the history and origins of ice cream and how our ice cream was made, and we bought books on it, we bought prints, we bought ephemera, we found references to ice cream dating from the 1600s. And along with this was the interest in making real ice cream, in discovering the old recipes that people used to use to make ice cream. All these wonderful recipes that have simply disappeared as the mass market manufacturers just force us to have more and more boring ice cream filled with air.
One of the first things that people ask us is, do you need an ice cream machine to make ice cream? And the answer is quite simple, no you don't, but it just makes life a lot easier. Here we have in front of me here two ice cream machines that are the top end of the range, £200 and £300. They are large, they are heavy, because they have their own built-in ice cream freezing units, but they will make ice cream all day, every day. Middle range is this type and this one here. They are both based on the same principle of a freezing canister. This one is the electrically driven model. This one is a hand crank model. It's very simple, ideal for children to use, great fun. This one is my own favorite. This one is circa 1930s, a wooden bucket, old fashioned hand cranked churn. Makes superb ice cream every time. 1930s is quite a difficult year to find, so you can buy a modern version. And that is this one. Superb ice cream every time.
Right, well, we're going to move on to ice cream makers in a moment, but I want to show you first of all how to make an ice cream quite simply without an ice cream maker. This is a very special one for a very special occasion. It's quite rich. It's one I first tasted on a visit to Glasgow. There's a restaurant there called the Ubiquitous Chip. And I tasted this ice cream, and quite frankly, it was one of the best I've ever tasted. And I managed to persuade them to give me the recipe, so here it is. You start off with a very Scottish ingredient. In the frying pan here, I've got some very coarse oatmeal, and this is being toasted. You put it in a dry frying pan, no fat at all, and then you just toss it around for about 5 minutes. And then it gets nice and brown and toasted, as you can see. Now, as soon as it's ready, put it straight into a dish, because the frying pan gets very hot, and if you leave it in the frying pan, it'll just get really, really brown and go too far. Right, once the oatmeal is ready, the next thing you need to do is to make a caramel, because what this is going to have, this ice cream, it's sort of really special ingredient, is toasted oatmeal that's been caramelised. And in the saucepan here, I've got a sugar syrup. This is 3 ounces of sugar and 4 tablespoons of water. And what I've done before we started is just let it melt over a very low heat. What you need to do is make sure the sugar absolutely dissolves. You mustn't have any grains of sugar. And you can just stir it round. The best way to look at it is at the on the back of a wooden spoon like that. And if you don't see any grains of sugar left, you know that they've melted, and then you're ready to make your caramel. So then you need a really high heat, have it on full, and you don't touch it, you watch it like a hawk. Can't answer the phone. You've just got to stand there over the saucepan and watch that syrup gradually get darker and darker until it turns into the colour of runny honey. So this is all a visual thing here, so we'll just wait for that now to come to a caramel. Now you don't stir a caramel, you just swirl it around like that, and as you can see now it's becoming the colour of dark runny honey. So the heat goes off, And now we're just going to add the caramel. Sorry, we're going to add the oatmeal, the toasted oatmeal, to the caramel. In it goes. Now you get that lovely sort of burnt caramel aroma filling the kitchen. And the next stage now is to just pour that mixture onto an oiled baking sheet, which we've got waiting ready for us here. And then when it's on the baking sheet, spread it out and then leave it to get absolutely cold and crisp. What you'll end up with is a sort of caramelised oatmeal toffee. Now when it's cold, you just use a palette knife, it comes off the tin very easily, put it into a pestle and mortar. If you don't have a pestle and mortar, you can use the end of a rolling pin and a pudding basin. And I just want to show you the texture of this. You don't want it too uniform, you want it crushed up so that you've got some fine bits and some sort of crunchy bits. And this is what's going to go in the ice cream. Now there are several ways of making ice cream. The one I want to show you now is one where you use a sugar syrup. This is 4 ounces of sugar and 4 tablespoons of water, and the sugar's just been dissolved in the water, that's all. Next door I've got some pure vanilla extract, and I'm going to use 1/2 teaspoon of this. Watch when you're buying this though, because there are a lot of vanilla essences around that aren't really the real thing, so make sure you get proper vanilla extract. And then the other ingredient is, I'm afraid, a pint of whipping cream. I did say this is one for special occasions. We've got some lesser caloried ones later for you. 1 pint of whipping cream, and then you just combine those three together in a bowl, use an electric hand whisk and get it all up to the lovely thick floppy stage like this, and then it just gets transferred into a plastic freezer box, preferably one with a lid. Scrape it all into the box like this from the bowl, and then simply smooth it out, put the lid on, and then place it in the freezer. Now that should take about 2 hours to become partially frozen, but I can't actually guarantee the timing because lots of freezers vary and have different temperatures. But what you need to end up with is ice cream, or half ice cream, that's sort of quite frozen at the edges but still sort of soft in the middle. And then the secret of good ice cream is to actually whip it quite a lot. So you transfer it from the box, the half frozen ice cream goes into a mixing bowl. And then, if you had an ice cream maker, which we'll be looking at shortly, it would be paddling it and whipping it. But if you don't have one, you have to do it yourself. So switch on the beaters. If you don't have one of these, you can do it with a balloon whisk. A bit more elbow grease. And then just whip the frozen ice cream into the unfrozen and give it a really good, thorough whisking. I think you need to whisk it for 2 or 3 minutes to get it really, really thoroughly whisked. Doesn't that look absolutely glorious? Really thick and creamy, lovely colour too. But it's going to be even more glorious because now we're going to add the caramelised oatmeal. Just sprinkle that in and then take a tablespoon and just fold it into the mixture. Don't whisk the oatmeal in, the caramelised oatmeal, because the beaters on the whisk seem to separate the caramelised sugar from the oatmeal, and it's not so nice. So just use a folding method to get that into there. Now, the next thing you do is you transfer all of that into a 2-pound loaf tin. Cover it with foil, and then it goes back in the freezer for as long as you like until you're ready to serve it.
Remove the ice cream from the freezer to the fridge about 20 minutes before you want to serve it. Slice it with a sharp knife, dipped first in warm water. Then for a garnish, pour some puree around it. The first one here is raspberry and the second one is apricot. Finish with a garnish of red currants, which makes it look really pretty.
Right, well, having shown you how to make a caramel, you can use a caramel for other kinds of ingredients. This one here, which is a larger quantity than we made before, has got macadamia nuts turned into it instead of oatmeal. Macadamia nuts are the lovely big crunchy sort of buttery nuts that come from Australia. And then you can just crush that up and turn it into ice cream, or you can crush it up and sprinkle it over the top of plain vanilla ice cream. Now, if you don't want to make a caramel and go through all that, you can cheat a bit, because there's this lovely confection here, which is called turron. Now, if you hunt around your supermarkets and your specialised food shops, you'll find this comes in little packets, and this makes wonderful ice cream when it's crushed up into sort of quarter of an inch pieces, like I've got here. Now, the first ice cream we made was one with a sugar syrup. This one we're going to make now, which is turron ice cream, is made with a custard base. And you start off by making a custard with milk and egg yolks and sugar. This is a very easy, foolproof custard, and I'm going to show you how to do it later on. And to the custard, you add this here, which is half a pint of fromage frais, which is low in fat, and this together with there only being milk in the custard makes quite a low fat ice cream. So that goes in with the custard. Then we add the turron. The Italians make turron as well, and it's called turrone. Apparently both recipes came from the Moors, but we think the Spanish one is less expensive and actually even better. Give that a good mix. And now I'm going to show you how to make ice cream in a middle-of-the-road ice cream maker that costs about £50 or so. And if you use an ice cream maker, it cuts out getting the ice cream out of the freezer, putting it into a bowl and whipping it up, because it does all the churning for you. Now I'm just going to put the mixture back into my jug. And that's ready for the machine. And here it is. What it is, it's an electric paddle, and it's fitted onto this canister. The canister goes into your freezer for 24 hours. It gets nice and cold inside and ready to freeze, and the paddle churns the ice cream. So I'll switch it on and show you how to proceed. Pour the mixture in with the paddle running. And the ice cream, inside the ice cream maker, will take about 20 to 30 minutes to actually thicken. It's not a good idea, I don't think, to serve it straight from here, although you could do. It's better then to transfer it to a freezing box and keep it in a freezing box until you're ready to serve it. I'm going to switch that off now and show you the finished turron ice cream, which is here. There it is. It's churned in the ice cream maker, then transferred to the freezer, and then you can serve it whenever you want to serve it. It's nice just having it tucked away for a rainy day to bring out for a dessert. And then I just want to show you this little gadget here, which is a very good ice cream scoop. This is the type to buy. And all you do is you have a nice long box with lots of length here, and you just slide that along to make ice cream scoops. There we are, turron ice cream.
And one of the nicest accompaniments to this particular ice cream is this very colourful compote of mixed summer fruits. And now I want to show you some more five-star ice creams. This is a gooseberry ice cream here, flavoured with elderflower cordial and made with a glucose syrup to give it a lovely soft velvety texture. Another favourite is lemon meringue ice cream. This has a sharp lemon flavour to contrast with the sweet crunchiness of the meringue. If you want to have some fun, this is fresh strawberry cheesecake ice cream with stripes of strawberry puree, and this time with sweet biscuits, giving it texture and crunch. The next one is unbelievable. Just imagine all the flavour and texture of rhubarb crumble and cream frozen into ice cream.
Now I want to show you another very simple but very, very special ice cream. This is coconut ice cream and it's made with a custard base. And I did tell you I was going to show you how to make a custard, a foolproof one. You start off with 3 egg yolks and then you add to the egg yolks a teaspoonful, a rounded teaspoonful of corn flour. Now when you're making a custard, if you always get that little bit of corn flour in, you'll find that it'll never ever curdle, or if it does, it'll come back again, it'll be re-stabilised by that. Now I'm going to add some vanilla essence, about half a teaspoonful. Sorry, vanilla extract, not vanilla essence. The real thing this is. And then I've got here 4 ounces of caster sugar. And I'm going to start making my custard by just mixing those together. And now, the ice cream is going to have what can only be described as a magic ingredient. And that magic ingredient is this one here. And that's 5 tablespoons of something called coconut, instant coconut powder. And I know it sounds very unlikely, but it's a wonderful ingredient and can be used in lots and lots of dishes. And what I'm going to do with that 5 tablespoons of instant coconut powder is put it into some milk, which I've been heating here. And then just give it a whisk. And then as soon as it comes up to boiling point, I'm going to pour the hot coconut milk onto the rest of the custard mixture and then transfer it back to the heat. Now that's just come up to simmering point now. In it goes. Give it a little mix as you pour it in with the whisk. You can use coconut milk made with this coconut powder for rice puddings, for, I heard of a recipe the other day, I haven't tried it yet, for chocolate blancmange made with coconut milk. Sounds rather nice, that. Perhaps better for the winter. Then back to the heat. Put the custard back in the saucepan and then whisk it until it's thickened. Then as soon as it's thick enough, turn the heat out and leave the custard to get completely cold. Bring on the cold custard, which is waiting here patiently, and then it gets another ingredient, which is 2.5 fluid ounces of whipping cream, and the whipping cream has been whipped to the sort of floppy consistency. And that's not much cream, just 2.5 fluid ounces. Now you can either churn this in an ice cream maker, or you can put it in a freezer box and whip it yourself, as I showed you before. And then you will have the most beautiful, wonderful coconut ice cream, which is going to be served with yet another wonderful ingredient.
Coconut ice cream has a very special affinity with fresh limes. This is a lime syrup, and it's made with sugar, freshly squeezed lime juice, and the thinly paired zest of the limes, which is then cut into very fine shreds. The syrup is thickened with a little arrowroot, and the combination of coconut ice cream and lime syrup is really quite sensational.
I want to show you another fabulous recipe. This is one to make when there's a glut of strawberries around. If you've been out to a strawberry farm and picked too many, this is a lovely way to preserve them. This is called strawberry granita, and you start off with 1 pound of strawberries, which you've hulled and rinsed under the tap, and you put them into a food processor. If you don't have a food processor, then you have to do quite a lot of sieving. This does save quite a bit of time. Then you put the lid on and whiz the strawberries to a puree. If you're wondering what a granita is, it's not a sorbet, it's not an ice cream. When you're making ice cream, one of the things that you have to keep avoiding all the time is having little crystals of ice. But when you make a granita, it's all about crystals of ice. That's exactly what a granita is. It's frozen crystals of ice that have lovely flavour. And you can make them with any kind of fruit at all. Now when it becomes a puree, or almost, because there's usually a few little escaped bits that have to go be pushed down, the next ingredient is sugar. And I've got 6 ounces of caster sugar here, and the recipe will eventually serve 8 people, so that's not as much sugar as it probably sounds. Blend the sugar in next. And then the last ingredient is a pint of water, and this has had 3 tablespoons of lemon juice added. Now, when all the water has been blended in, the next thing you have to do is put it through a sieve, because there are a few little pips in strawberries and we want to get rid of those. When you're sieving fruit, always use a nylon sieve, because sometimes if you use a metal sieve, it discolours the fruit. So all we want to do now is just squash the last of that through. And needless to say, you can make a granita with other fruits. You can make it with raspberries, you can make it with any kind of fruit at all. There we are, there's a few little pips left over there. Now this gets poured into a freezer box, lid on, in the freezer, and you wait until it's half frozen. Now, after about 2 hours, but this will vary from freezer to freezer, you'll get a mixture like this. There's always some clinging to the lid, so we'll just push that back in. You can see it's sort of half frozen. It's frozen around the edges, but there's still a little pool of liquid. So you just fork that with a fork, mix it together. You can't make this, you can't make a granita in the ice cream maker, because otherwise you get sorbet. This one shouldn't be churned, but just forked like this, so it becomes granular. You want it granular. Now that goes back into the freezer, has another hour or so, and then you give it another forking, then back in the freezer again. And this here is what your finished granita will look like. And you can see the texture. It's lovely and sort of crystally and granular and looks very pretty and tastes absolutely marvellous.
But I think I ought to give you a bit of a warning here. Once you've made strawberry granita, you'll have to make tons more while the season lasts.
Now we're going to move on to something which is a cross between an ice cream sundae and a drink, and that's an ice cream soda. You need a nice tall glass for this, and you put into the glass 2 scoops of vanilla ice cream, and then you use a flavouring syrup. I've got lime syrup here that we used with the coconut ice cream, about 3 fluid ounces. It's not vital, the amount. And then you top that up with some soda water. It's got to be fizz, whatever you use. Just slowly pour the soda water in, because what you're going to get is a beautiful, lovely, sort of frothy head, which looks so pretty and so cool and summery. And this is lovely to give children. And you can make it with any kind of syrup. I've got some more syrups to show you here. I think what would be very nice in an ice cream soda would be the elderflower cordial that we used when we made gooseberry recipes. Put a straw in, have a spoon to eat the ice cream, and that's ice cream soda. Quite simple, but quite lovely. Now, these are homemade concentrates to make homemade lemonade. And if you haven't tasted homemade lemonade, then you really ought to make it. This one here is just plain lemonade, and this one is lemon barley water. And what you can do, you can make both of those with limes or with oranges. Now, I'm going to move on and show you a little bit of fun, because this drink here is actually pineapple skin. If you're eating a pineapple, you know that horrible skin that you throw away? Well, try not throwing it away once. Put it in a glass jug, top it up with water, and leave it not even in the fridge, but at room temperature. And in about 2 or 3 days, it begins to sort of ferment and bubble, and it turns into this, which is the most beautiful, cool summer drink. Serve it with lots of ice. Oh, and I forgot to tell you to put some sugar in. You need to put a little bit of sugar in before you serve it. Strain it into a glass. And that really does make an unusual drink, and I think it's fun just using those horrible old pineapple skins. Now, I think a cool summer drink for a hot day that's a star. This is something that's served a lot in America. We don't seem to serve it very much here, but that's iced tea. Now, to make iced tea, you start in a teapot with some strong tea. I use 6 English breakfast tea bags, approximately 2 pints of water, and put about 6 sprigs of mint in. Then you put some sugar, about 2 tablespoons, and you just leave the tea to get completely cold. So it infuses for a long time, and you end up, you can see the colour of this here, with very, very strong tea. But it has to be strong to start off with because you're going to pour it over lots and lots of ice, which I've got waiting here in my jug. And then it's going to be diluted with orange juice. And really, when you serve this, it's like a sort of non-alcoholic Pimm's. It's really nice. Half a pint of freshly squeezed orange juice. And then lots more sprigs of mint. About 8 more sprigs of mint. I'll just use a spoon there to get the mint down into it. And then some slices of lime, slices of orange, and slices of lemon. And then one more little thing, just to give it a kick, as they say. And that's the juice of half a lime. This just actually does make quite a bit of difference. There we are. So that's iced tea. Give it a good stir. And it really is the most refreshing summer drink. Serve it, again, with lots of ice. And perhaps a few more sprigs of mint. And that's iced tea. Well, that's all for this week. Next week, I hope you'll come back to join me for a programme on summer fish and shellfish. So I look forward to seeing you then. Bye-bye. Welcome to a programme which this week is all about summer fish and shellfish. Fish is actually ideal for summer because it's very fast to cook and none of us wants to be in the kitchen when we've got lovely sunny days outside. It's also light to eat. But there is one little problem, and that is that sadly a lot of the family fishmongers up and down the country are closing down and disappearing. But I would urge you to go and look in the fish counter of your local supermarket, where you will find some very well prepared, well packed fish that is quite easily accessible and good to cook. Well, one of those is this one here, which is Mediterranean prawns. These are lovely, fat, juicy prawns, and we're going to make a salad. Well, it's actually called hot and sour prawns, but it's like a salad and very light and summery. But before I begin the recipe, I just want to show you how to deal with these. If they come in the shells, they don't always. Sometimes you can get them in a pack with the shells off. But if they come in the shells, this is how to deal with them. You just pull off the head, first of all, and any little bits around it. And then, underneath the fish, where the feet are, you can peel off the skin. It's like a little Macintosh, really, and it comes off quite easily. You can see how nice and easy that's coming off. Take away the legs. And the end bit down here needs to come off. But what I want for this recipe is to actually leave the tails on. We're not going to eat the tails, but they actually look nice and pretty. And then the next thing you need to do is to take a knife, a sharp knife, and just run it along the back of the prawn like this. Still got a little bit of shell there that I haven't taken off. And then inside, if I open it out, you can see there's a sort of black thread there. And what you need to do is take the thread out, use the knife and just push it out with the knife. In fact, it's actually better to do this under a cold running tap. But I just wanted to show you the procedure. And then your prawn will be washed and ready to go. And what we've got here are 16 fat, juicy Mediterranean prawns, and they're going to go in a dish. And then they're going to have some other ingredients along with them. And the first one is this lovely creature. This is a yellow pepper, lovely and summery looking, I think, yellow peppers are. And you need half of this, so just take off half the pepper with a sharp knife. Remove the pips, the seeds inside. And there's sometimes a little bit in the top there that needs to come out. And then slice it into lovely thin slices. And the slices are going in to join the prawns. If there's any pithy bits, just pull those out as you go. Now, I don't know about you, in your family and amongst your friends, but I find that more and more people are becoming what I call semi-vegetarian. And that means that, really, quite a lot of fish is needed, because semi-vegetarians, although they've given up meat, they still eat fish. So it's good to have lots of nice fish recipes up your sleeve. So slice them really, really thinly like that. And then they go in to join the prawns, which is a nice, pretty colour contrast. And then I've got some red pepper, which has been prepared in the same way, just sliced up really nice and thinly. And then the next ingredient is a red onion. And this also, half of this we're going to use,